Sunday after Thanksgiving is one of those Sundays where you never know what you're going to get at church. Some Sundays, it is the first Sunday of Advent and we look forward to Christmas. And some Sundays, it's not. It is the last Sunday of the year. This year, it is the last Sunday of the year, Reign of Christ Day. And that explains why we're in a strange part in John's Gospel. We're in that part that is the passion narrative, and at the beginning of Jesus' trial with Pilate. The lectionary people who put, the people who put together the lectionary chose this particular reading, not because of the time of year, but because of what they felt it expressed about God, about Jesus, and kingship. Let us listen for God's voice speaking through these words. Then Pilate entered the headquarters, again, summoned Jesus and asked, "Are you king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own or do others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. For this I was born." Pilate asked him, "So are you a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." May God add a blessing of understanding to our hearing of these words. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts and spirits be inspired by your Holy Spirit and thus made pleasing to you, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Despite having overthrown the British royal monarchy over 2.25 centuries ago, it seems Americans still love the royals. Last spring, an estimated 29.2 million of us watched the wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, and they watched it live. And that doesn't include the number of people who watched it over streaming systems, or those who, like me, couldn't see getting up at 5 a.m. to watch it, and so watched it later in the day. Some of the size of the audience could be attributed to that Meghan was an American, and so many wanted to see an American become a princess. Despite throwing off that royal rule in the American Revolution, the spectacle of these royal events still draws a wide American audience. And really, it's mainly the spectacle that fascinates most Americans. Most would be appalled to be governed by a monarch who inherits the throne and then governs the country for life. Today in Britain, even the royal family only performs mainly ceremonial and charitable functions. The governing is done by the duly elected officials of the parliament. And despite that, at least 14 countries right now have ruling monarchies that have authority. For many people, the idea of having a monarchy seems quaint, antiquated. So, observing the reign of Christ on Sunday may seem strange. It was originally entitled Christ the King Sunday in 1925. Pope Pius XI designated that day to be a feast for the Roman Catholic Church. For a while, what would be known as World War I had come to an end, the rise of nationalism and increasing class divisions in society, as well as our human inclination to solve all our conflicts through violence. He saw these were contradictions to true peace. And the only way that he saw for true peace was acknowledgement of Jesus as being King of all. And while this has overtones of that mentality that was behind the horrors of history, such as the Spanish Inquisition or the Crusades, Pius understood the reign being established by different means. For Jesus Christ reigns over the minds of individuals by his teachings, in their hearts by his love, in each one's life by living according to his law and imitating his example. Later, it was renamed the Reign of Christ Sunday, as many Western people have little experience with ruling kings, and it brings about an image of authoritarianism. Today, this Sunday has been adopted by most Protestant denominations as the last Sunday of the church year, just before Advent. Today is designated a day to consciously, thoughtfully ask yourself, who rules our lives? For something does, make no mistake about it. Whether it be a person or fears, dreams, even God's own self, there is something that is a ruling force in your life. It may be a person, how one defines their own identity. Ideals can be a ruling force, as well as ideologies. Consumerism is driven by the understanding of this, the hope that the quest for popularity, youth, or more rules will result in something that people love and will buy. How many of you would be willing to give up your cell phones or leave them at home? I know that mine sat beside me as I wrote this sermon, and I feel almost panicked when I realize that it's not with me. And if that doesn't describe a ruling force in our life, I don't know what does. Today we are asked to consider, what role does God play in your life? This echoes through the question that Pilate asks. So, are you a king? Now, when Pilate asks this, he isn't thinking about, oh, maybe switching his allegiance to Jesus and becoming one of his followers. Pilate is only interested in the political implications of Jesus' answer. If only Jesus would admit that he was king, it will expedite the process to his trial through his crucifixion and death, for they could then easily try him for treason and attempting to usurp the authority of the Roman Empire. But Jesus answers to Pilate of the question, so are you a king? That reveals that they're talking about two different things. Jesus' statement, my kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over. That baffles Pilate, for Jesus reveals a different goal than even self-preservation. For the Romans and their appointed religious hierarchy, kingdom means territory conquered, people and resources available for and used for consumption, and a title that puts you at the top. Jesus is describing something different, something not of this world. And Jesus' answer baffles many still today. Some believe that the reign of Jesus describes only the life after death, or that it's on some different spiritual plane separate from this world. I don't happen to believe that. For when the author of the Gospel of John refers to the world, he isn't talking about the earth, the territory, and the resources on it. The world that he refers to is all those human defaults, that we use violence, fear, oppression as authority and as power. The world in the Gospel of John is defined by the need for someone or something to be at the top, necessitating that others must be at the bottom. It's the world that says, there isn't enough. You need to look out for your own. The reign of God that Jesus comes to exemplify and reveal rejects these ways. Instead, it establishes authority through the way his followers will live out what Jesus has demonstrated throughout his life: love, justice, and peace. The same love that God has for all. This won't be some future brought in by armies, miraculous interventions, or even democratic elections. Jesus is already victorious through his rejection of all the ways of power that are asserted by Pilate and the Caesars of the world. The reign Jesus reveals is one that is brought about through service, out of love for others, not domination and submission. Gospel of John scholar Caroline Lewis says that when we don't define Jesus' reign as an establishment of government or institutions, as being limited to some particular land, we realize suddenly that Jesus' kingdom is a state of being, a way to live, a commitment to a particular way to view the world. And that state of being, well, for Jesus, it clashes with the Roman Empire, and it continues to clash with the powers of today, be they economic or social or political. Loving your enemy bangs up against seeking retribution and justice. Welcoming the stranger and those on the outer margins goes against that desire to maintain safety and authority. Living in ways so that all have enough food, enough medical help, enough shelter, enough love, quarrels with that push to race to the top, as well as looking out for oneself and one's own. Every person already being a beloved child of God, no matter who or what or where, as we sang earlier, that contradicts the narrative that everything must be earned and deserved. Establishment of true justice and freedom by God challenges those who draw borders and boundaries to keep some out and keep others in. So Pilate can't grasp that Jesus isn't establishing his territory by conquering by conquering lands and people. Jesus, in his body in God's reign, and inviting others to do the same. So truth for Pilate is about visible facts and the assertion of power. For Jesus, truth is the way of living out the ways of God's love that reflect the reality that there is enough. Enough love, resources, security, or anything that we are told is too limited or too scarce. For God does desire good for all. Even for Pilate, even for the religious leaders, even for the disciples who will abandon him shortly. That all sounds pretty good, doesn't it? So why don't we live that way? Perhaps it's because we've seen what happens to those who have dared to live out this reality. Some are ridiculed as being naive or branded something much worse. Others are silenced, driven out of jobs, groups, even families, and relegated to the back where their voice can no longer be heard. And then there are those who are rejected by their friends, by their family members, because they aren't willing to see themselves as being better or more deserving than others. They end up like Jesus and lose their life, whether it be the life of the actual breath of their body, or more commonly now, the life that has been lived by them up to that point. When many turning into the Prince Harry wedding, it was just to see an American become part of the royal family. But it was another American who almost stole the show. Chicago native and first black presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, Mike Curry, gave the homily, and his sermon took aback many of the people. And it wasn't just because his style of preaching was something that had never been heard within the walls of those cathedrals. He spoke of the couple's love for each other, and then of God's love for us, rattling the walls with declarations of the power of that love. The way of unselfish, sacrificial, redemptive love can change lives, and it can change this world, he said. And then he asked them to imagine, what would it be like if the ways of the world, of the people who inhabit it, actually followed that way? He sees it this way. No child would go to bed hungry in such a world as that. When love is the way, we will let justice stroll down like a mighty stream, and righteousness like an ever-flowing brook. The love that Jesus displayed went beyond romance or even family connections. Jesus of Nazareth taught us that the way of love is the way to real relationship with God and the way to true relationship with each other as children of the one God, as brothers and sisters in God's family. Quoting Charles Marsh, he concluded, Jesus has founded the most revolutionary moment and movement in human history, a movement built on the unconditional love of God for the world and the mandate to live that love. I'm talking about power, he said, real power, power to change the world. I would like to say that I always live under and within the reign of that power of God's love, but I don't. Too often I find that I'm living under the powers of this world instead as part of the reign that Jesus reveals. Yet even then, the truth is that you are already living under the reign of God's love and compassion, a reign where God forgives the failures, the falling short, unlike the world that demands consequences for failures. God only asks us to accept the love that God is already offering us, the love that enables us to live out within the world, in the midst of what can seem at times like darkness and hopelessness, and then transforms it all into a fresh reality of God's love and peace. Whose reign would you rather live under? God's of love or the world? That is what we're asked to consider today. How would you answer it? Amen.